my first Q&A video. In this video, I'll be answering your questions that you asked me on Twitter, Instagram, and Periscope. Really excited to be doing one of these, so let's get started. First question. Dance Electric JC on Instagram asks, is having a credit card from an airline to collect miles worth it? Let me first start out by telling you how I feel about credit cards. I personally don't like using credit cards in general. They've gotten me into a lot of trouble in the past, but if I am going to carry one credit card, I might as well be earning miles. I do think it's worth it for certain airlines as long as the total value outweighs the annual fee. Typically, there's a fee of around $100 a year. The way that I would recommend doing it is to use that credit card for all my monthly expenses, groceries, gas, daily life expenses, and then put everything on that card, and then at the end of the month, paying it all off with what's in my main bank account. That is going to maximize my point earning potential. However, there is great danger in doing it this way if you don't have the discipline to know exactly what's in your regular bank account at the end of the month. And if you overspend, it's a really bad habit to get into and it's a really slippery slope. So I caution you against doing it this way unless you have the discipline to do so. So that said, it really depends on how often you travel and how often you travel with a specific airline. If you don't really travel that much, the yearly cost might not be worth it. If you do travel a lot, it actually pays off because of the perks that you get. Things like priority boarding, seat upgrades, free checked bags, discounts on in-flight meals, access to airport lounges, things like that. Now, the way that it works is typically one credit card mile is the equivalent of 1 cent. So that means that you would have to spend $1,000 in order to get $10 in rewards. So unless you plan to use this card for daily life or large purchases, it's probably not going to be worth it. Usually it takes about 30,000 miles to get a domestic round trip flight and 50,000 for an international one. And just because you've earned the points does not mean you get to use them. A lot of the times the airlines will have blackout dates and those are typically going to be around the holidays, probably when you would want to travel. But if you fly frequently with the same airline, you'll probably find more opportunities to redeem those points. The best time to apply for one of these cards is right before a major trip that you have coming up. Usually these credit cards will offer you major sign-up bonuses like an entire round-trip ticket or a free companion ticket. So in answer to your question, if you do fly frequently with one particular airline, I do think that it makes sense. If not, then a travel rewards credit card is actually a better option. A travel rewards credit card gives you miles that you can redeem on lots of different airlines, and then you're not stuck with just one particular airline. There are a few out there. Chase Sapphire Preferred has a really good reputation. Capital One Venture. These are examples of travel credit cards that aren't co-branded with one particular airline, but they offer the option for you to transfer these points to multiple airlines. Now, the downside to going this route is that you wouldn't get those benefits that you get with the airline one, like priority boarding, seat upgrades. So you'd be giving up those perks for more options. Ricardo Mendoza 5448 asks, is TSA PreCheck worth it? Yes, especially if you fly a lot. You get to leave your shoes on, you get to leave your jacket on, you get to leave your laptop and your liquids inside your bag. You don't have to take any of that stuff out. It's just less hassle, and the security screening process takes a fraction of the amount of time. So just last month, for example, wait times were reported for about 93% of travelers at less than 5 minutes. It's a really easy process. You fill out an application online, they run a background check, you schedule an in-person appointment where you bring your documents and sit there for 10 minutes talking to them, you pay an $85 membership fee, and then they send you out the door. Now, if you often fly internationally, it's actually better to apply for global entry because that automatically gives you access to TSA PreCheck. It's $100 to apply, and some credit cards will actually fully reimburse you for this fee. So again, if you travel a lot, all of these options are totally worth it, but definitely getting through security is a breeze. Next question. On Instagram, StockParl asks, have you ever just booked the flight and only looked for accommodation on arrival? I'm an overplanner and I have terrible OCD. I like to have full control over my plan and what I'm gonna do. I wanna know exactly where I'm sleeping. Case in point, I had a 12-hour layover in San Francisco one time, was not planning on staying there, did not wanna sleep at the airport, so I decided to go book a room in town. It turns out that the same day that I was there for my layover was also the same day that this huge Salesforce convention was in town. All the hotels were completely booked, and the only ones that were available were like $600, $700 a night. And these were like Motel 8, Hojo, mom and pop places that were just gouging. And so unfortunately what I ended up doing was driving about 45 minutes out of town in order to get a decent place for kind of affordable. So I would say go ahead and do that as long as you're flexible enough to do what I did and travel a little bit outside should that be necessary. Next question. Magnus Valente asks, what is the best way to find low price flight tickets? I love using HipMonk and Skyscanner to find the best deals. I'll also set up alerts that will notify me when the prices drop on a search that I've run. I think the best way to save money on airfare is to be as flexible as you possibly can with your date, the day of the week, your location. If you can be flexible, then you're more likely to get the lowest airfare. If you can travel outside of peak season for that particular destination, you're gonna save lots more money. The day of the week that you leave and return also makes a huge difference. If you leave on a Thursday and come back on a Monday, you can save up to 20%, whereas if you leave on a Friday and come back on a Saturday or Sunday, you're gonna spend so much more. The other thing to remember to do, now this is really tricky of the airlines, but make sure that when you run your search, you do it on a private browser because they do track each search. Haven't you noticed that after you run the same search for a few times, the price all of a sudden just spikes up out of nowhere? That's not coincidental, that actually happens because they're watching you, yeah. Your search activity is being monitored and they will hike up the price just to scare you into buying sooner for fear that they're gonna go up even more. Terrible tactic. So just make sure that you're surfing in private mode. Another way to save money is if you know where and when you're going, like if you have a trip that's coming up, try and book as early as possible before the prices increase. A good rule of thumb is 6 to 8 weeks in advance if you can. Next question. Worst username ever on Instagram asks, what was the most surprisingly underrated place you've ever been to? I would say the San Juan Islands. It's very relaxing. There's lots to do. There's hiking, there's waterfalls, kayaking, whale watching. It's beautiful. The towns are so charming. I absolutely loved my time on Orcas Island. Totally gorgeous. Perfect getaway in the Pacific Northwest if you're looking for something to do. I've lived in the Seattle area for several years and I don't think it gets talked about enough. Next question. Monif asks, do you book your flights online or through a travel agency? I always try to book directly through the airline because I feel like I'm my own travel agent. Now, if you don't have time to do your own research and find the best deals online, or you're just overwhelmed by all of the options, then maybe a travel agent would be the way to go. The benefits of booking with a travel agent are you have access to their expertise and industry connections. They can negotiate some better deals for you usually. They're also very helpful in sorting out any travel hiccups like natural disasters, flight delays, changes in schedule, things like that. But if saving money is a priority, then you're probably better off booking on your own. Next question comes from Kif Long on Twitter. Which is better and why? Lowering and stretching costs out so you spend more time in that location, or spending large on a couple key aspects of a vacation which results in less time in that location? I really like this question a lot because I find myself in this situation where I kind of want to do both. I feel like it's a really good idea if you can find a good balance. So splurge in a couple of areas because it's not every day that you're going to find yourself at that location and you only live once. But at the same time, you should try to save money in other areas. For example, if you're traveling to a place that's really big on outdoor activities and you don't see yourself spending much time in your room, I would say it's okay to skimp on the hotel. Granted, there's no cockroaches and it's not super duper duper low budget. If you only need a place to sleep, then that would be the place to save money, and then you can splurge on the outdoor activities. I think your best bet is to pick a couple of things that are really important to you about that location, whether it's a restaurant or a certain excursion, some sort of activity, a museum you've always wanted to see. I think those things are worth spending the money on because you're only gonna have that opportunity because you're there. And then try to save money in the other areas like transportation. Just try walking everywhere. Lots of places these days have those Lime scooters or Lime bikes that you can just rent, and they're really affordable. It's an easy and fun way to get around. Next question is from Twitter. Trapper008 asks, how would you suggest buying a ticket? Would you rather buy from a secondary source like Travelocity or Expedia, etc., or a primary source like buying directly from the airline? So I like to use those resources in conducting my search, but then when it comes time for me to make reservations, reservations, I'll actually go directly to the hotel or directly to the airline. Now, the reason I don't like booking through third parties is I've been burned in the past, but they have very little flexibility whenever there's a change in plans. You can't easily make any reservation changes. Whereas when you book directly with the hotel or airline, they're more likely to be flexible in changing a reservation for you. The other thing about third parties is you can't earn loyalty points or rewards. So just something to keep in mind. Next question comes from Pet Architect on Twitter. When traveling to another country, is it best to exchange money at a local bank before leaving or wait until you get to the country you're traveling to? Well, my best piece of advice would be to use your local bank if you can to exchange currency before you leave. They usually charge the lowest exchange fees, where if you do it at the airport kiosk, it's going to be much higher of a fee. If you do end up using your own bank or credit union, find out if they'll buy back unused currency when you return. If not, you can exchange your money at a currency exchange store. Now, ideally, you should find out if the place you're traveling to is plastic friendly. You can avoid extra travel fees this way, and these days, lots of credit cards and debit cards have no foreign transaction fees. But if the place you're going to deals mostly in cash, it's best to get that at home before you go. Next question comes from Never, or Nev3R on Twitter, asks, what apps have helped the most when traveling? Does Google Translate help in all countries you don't speak the language? Great question. So one of my favorite apps was Google Translate. We were in Paris and my dad actually typed questions to our Uber driver and had a full-on conversation with him. It was really great because he could just type in his question and then he hit a button that actually spoke to the person and he totally understood what my dad was saying. They had a full-on conversation. It was great. One thing I did notice was there's no Cantonese. So when I was over in Hong Kong, I couldn't use Google Translate. However, it does offer lots of different languages. Another travel app that I love is FlightAware. It gives you the most up-to-date information about your flight in real time. It allows you to track real-time flight status and gives you a tracking map of any commercial flight in the world. It also sends you push notifications and flight alerts whenever you have a delay or if there's a gate change. It's got you covered. I also love XE Currency. It gives you local currency information based on your phone's current location. So you program your home base's currency and it will automatically compute the conversion wherever you are in the world. It also works offline by remembering the last location your phone was connected to Wi-Fi. Next question comes from MVG512. Have you ever lost anything valuable? Oh my goodness. So I didn't lose it, but one time I was in a rush through security, like everybody is, and once I got to the other side, I was so quick to get my shoes and my bag, and I forgot to grab my laptop. So I ended up running to the gate. About a minute later, I realized that my bag wasn't as heavy as it usually is. And then it dawned on me that I left my laptop. So I ran back to security and luckily it was still there. I ended up grabbing it, throwing it into my bag, and that was it. But it could have been worse. I'm so glad I got it, but I'll never make that mistake again. Next question comes from Rev Ampler on Instagram. Have you ever been lost? Luckily, I've never been lost traveling, knock on wood. But I was lost this one time for an hour in a corn maze one Halloween. And after an hour of stressing out, trying to find my way out, I decided to use the expensive device that's in my pocket to look at the map, the satellite map, and navigate my way out. So that isn't really travel related, but it answers your question, kind of. Hopefully I don't get lost. Next question comes from Asha Balani 12018. When did the travel bug start? So the travel bug started for me in the military. My very first country that I went to was Turkey. I was fascinated by the culture and just the way of life. It was so much different than ours. I just fell in love with getting to know the culture and the differences and the similarities, learning how to navigate my way around a country that speaks an entirely different language than mine. I just grew in an instant passion for travel. The next country I ended up going to was Greece, and I was sold. I was completely awestruck by the difference in vibe when I was there, and I started to realize that each city, each place that you go to carries its own unique vibe. And I was hooked. It was so exciting to me, and I can't really explain it. It's just each location has a different vibe to it, and I wanted to kind of experience as many different vibes as I could and learn all that I could about each country, and I really wanted to start exploring more. So even before the military, my dream was to go to the moon, and in order to get to the moon, I thought I would go into the Air Force so that I could get into NASA. It's this big long story. Life kind of took a different turn for me. But my original goal in going to the moon was I just wanted to explore. I just wanted to get out there. And when I was in the military, I was able to get out there in a sense. And now, even today, I have the heart of an astronaut. I just want to explore, and I just want to show you guys all the things and get you just as pumped and excited about it as I am. Thank you so much to those of you who put so much thought into the questions for me. I really enjoyed doing this for you. I hope I was able to answer those questions. And if you want to see more videos like this, let me know below in the comments that you enjoyed this and I can see about doing this periodically. Thanks so much for being here. If you liked this video, give it a thumbs up. And if you want to see more travel videos, I encourage you to subscribe. And also, don't forget to hit that bell so you know when new content is posted. And as always, happy travels. I encourage you to excribe. You get to leave your shoes, your jacket off. No, on. Oh my gosh.